Thank you so much, Anand, for joining me on this conversation. I've set the context for our viewers and I've told them what the riskometer essentially was meant to do. I want to understand from you as an advisor, has this made your life just a little bit easier when you have to communicate to someone that you're advising how exactly the risk picture for a particular investment is going to be, and also why do you think it was necessary for the SEBI to come in and say you need to be a little bit more targeted in your communication with regard to the riskometer?
Hi, firstly, thank you for having me on the show. See, SEBI has asked that now mutual fund will have to disclose riskometer, performance and portfolio details to investors only to the fund, only for the fund that he's invested in. This will probably help in enhancing the quality of information, whether it is in respect of risk or returns. Plus, it will help investors not to be flooded with information. See, having information is always good, but having too much of information usually creates a situation of confusion. I always believe one thing, that we should always keep it simple. And now finally, SEBI is trying to make it simple. So it's a welcome step for all the investors, or maybe even for distributors or advisors for that matter.
Anand, take us through the riskometer and what has your learning been from this? Is this a dramatic shift from what you've seen in the past several years, where, for example, when this whole Franklin episode happened and in the run up to that, perhaps people didn't really understand the risk that a Franklin held, or a particular scheme of Franklin held, as opposed to another scheme in the same category?
Absolutely right. See, there has been a kind of riskometer in mutual funds since 2015. However, the earlier, no, the scheme usually used to have riskometer on category-wise basis. So they did not reflect the riskiness of the individual schemes or individual portfolio for that matter. And I personally believe this category-wise riskometer, which we were having earlier, was kind of misleading, because I will just give you an example. Suppose that all the large cap schemes of all the mutual fund houses are carrying the same level of risk. I think this is quite unfair, and we should have some kind of personalization. This was the very reason because of which Franklin episode happened, because investor used to think that Franklin is a short-term debt fund, which is giving me higher returns as compared to the same category of other fund, which is giving me lesser returns. And both the funds are having same kind of risk. Why not let me invest in Franklin fund? But investor didn't realize that Franklin was actually taking some exponential extra risk. And now by this new circular and this new regulation and new rating and new riskometer, it will solve the problem. And now fund house must assign riskometer on individual basis. And this will obviously provide more objective assessment of the riskiness of individual schemes. Now investors will actually know that if a fund is generating some extra return as compared to its competitor, it is because of some probably some good decision taken by its fund manager, or it is just because their fund is taking some extra risk. So this will probably have some more kind of clarity for the investors. And if we talk about how this riskometer is defined, no, for debt, there is a separate criteria which is used. For equity, there is a separate criteria which is used. For debt, we will be looking at three important points and three important type of risk which is there in debt fund. Credit risk, interest rate risk, liquidity risk. These three risks will be considered for deciding whether a fund is a low risk fund or maybe a very high risk fund. If you permit, can I go in details of the fund and the riskiness and how it is calculated?
Absolutely, absolutely. Please do. Please do. Please do.
Sure. So firstly, let me talk about debt funds. Debt funds riskiness is first criteria is credit risk. Suppose there is a fund which is investing in AAA rated products. They will be assigned a risk rating or a pointer of one. And versus if there is a fund which is investing in below investment grade products, it will be given the risk profiling of 12. Higher the risk profiling, more risky is that fund. And interest rate, if I try to explain in simple language, I know this is a concept which is usually misunderstood by many of the investors. Interest rate risk is your returns of debt product is inversely proportional to the yield movement. If there is rise in yield, your return in debt product will decrease. If there is fall in yield, your return in debt product will increase. and how much it will increase or decrease is defined by the duration of the product. For example, I am just giving a hypothetical example. There is a mutual fund which is having duration, modified duration of 5. So if yield increases by 1%, or approximately your fund returns should decrease by 5%, versus if yield decrease by 1%, your fund return will approximately increase by 5%. So this is the kind of risk which higher duration fund have. So if fund is having duration of 1 year, you will be given a duration of less than 0.5, you will be given risk profiling of 1. If you are having a duration of more than 4 years, you will be given risk profiling of 6. So this is the second important point. And third is liquidity risk. Liquidity risk is directly comparable with the credit quality of the product. If your product is having poor credit quality, it will have a high liquidity risk. It might be illiquid at times and at difficult times. So it will be having higher risk profiling and higher risk rating. If I talk about equity funds risk rating is defined based on 3 main criteria. First is the market capitalization. Large cap is given 5 points, mid cap 7 points, small cap 9 points. As we all know that large cap funds are comparatively less volatile and less risky, and small cap funds are probably more volatile and more risky. Second point is volatility. If daily volatility is more than 1, it is given 5 points. And if daily volatility is less than 1, it is given 5 points. And if it is more than 1, it is given 6 points. And third important point in equity funds risk profiling is the liquidity cost, or the impact cost for that matter. If impact cost is more, it is given higher rating. If impact cost is less, it is given lower rating. And we average up all the pointers. And finally, we find out what is the final rating of our fund. If rating of a fund is less than 1, it is a low risk fund or a low risk profile fund. And if rating or the final risk value of the fund is more than 5, it will be very high on the riskometer. So now this objectifying both equity and debt fund and making it very crisp and clear for the investor, what actually it will be useful for investors in long term.
Absolutely. And you've described it really well, Anand. I must point out, I attempted to break it down for our viewers, but you've listed out the parameters that determine the riskometer score for each scheme very clearly. I want to learn about your own experience with the riskometer though, and I want to understand why the SEBI has come in with this clarification. Were mutual funds really carpet bombing investors with information, and is that something that beyond the riskometer you see is a problem? There should be a better disclosure system.
See, I personally believe we were as such not having too much of information. We were having sufficient information, but simplifying the process is always welcomed. If we are learning throughout this process of mutual fund sahi and simplifying the process for our investors, it is obviously better. And riskometer is just one criteria which we consider. Major point in deciding whether we should use a fund or not is the risk profiling, suitability, and our goal and time horizon. So we have to think in a holistic manner and not just invest purely on the basis of risk profile or riskometer.
I think we've covered this topic sufficiently, Anand. Let's move on and talk about some of the queries that we've been sent by our viewers. In fact, we've got the first query coming in from Rohit Matu. He says that he's 40, living in Jammu, and he is a government employee. He has been investing 20,000 rupees in mutual funds, PPF and Sukanya Samriddhi for his daughter. Along with that, he's been paying an EMI for his apartment. He wishes to accumulate 1 crore to 1.5 crore over the next 20 years. And he's asking whether or not his investments are on the right track. Now, he's obviously not broken up his mutual fund investments, but perhaps we can give him some aid as to whether he's going in the right direction.
See, firstly, by saving 20,000 rupees per month, he will be able to reach his rough target of 1 crore in at the age of 60 with an expected rate of return of 11%. And I am very happy that the investor is doing proper diversification amongst different investment products. One thing which I would especially like to bring in notice for this investor, no, he is having 16 years plus time horizon, which is very good. But he should stick to this time horizon even after 3 years or 4 years, even after knowing that after 3 or 4 years, his equity returns or equity mutual fund returns might be impacted. It should not happen that right now, when past returns are very good, we are seeing superb returns in equity mutual fund, we are ready to invest for more than 10 years, 15 years, and something happens 3 years or 4 years down the line, we all of a sudden become from long-term investors to short-term investor. This should not happen if he will stick to his time horizon, and he's perfectly placed, and I don't think there should be any problem in it.
All right, then it's good news for Rohit. He's going along the right path. And in fact, consistency is the most important thing when you're looking at long-term investing, isn't it? Let's go to the second query then. We've got a question from Raghupati, who has got a 10-year time horizon. And he's asking whether it would be right for him to remove funds from PPF and invest it in a FlexiCap mutual fund. Is that even possible?
See, firstly, I would like to appreciate this investor because before investing, he's having a time horizon of 10 years, which is a good time horizon for equity mutual funds. But here we are trying to compare apple with oranges. PPF is a beautiful, one of the most beautiful debt product, and we are comparing it with equity. As we were completely discussing about riskometer and risk profiling all throughout this episode, I feel both these products have different set of risk profile, and we should not miss debt or debt and equity. Both are completely different set of product and both have its importance. You should first define your suitability and risk profile and then decide on investing in a FlexiCap fund. And using complete PPF money and shifting it to FlexiCap fund, this can be really dangerous. We should first define our risk profile and then take any such decision.
Okay, the third question that we have for you is from Vijay Chand, and he's got an equity portfolio that consists of a few SIP, or rather he's doing SIPs in a few mutual fund schemes, and he's asking whether he should continue. I'll read them out for you. Axis Blue Chip, Mirai Asset Emerging Equity, Kotak Standard Multicap, and Tata PE Fund.
Sure. See, one thing I should specifically mention to this investor is that he's ignoring debt for an asset class. Debt is an important asset class and should always form a part of an investor's portfolio. I know equity has given you superb returns in recent past and all your SIPs and equity mutual fund portfolio is looking superb, but we should never underestimate the importance of debt products. I know going forward, also next 2 to 3 years, debt products will be giving comparatively lower returns because right now interest rates are really low. But when we will see from 5 years, 10 years down the line, whenever there is any shock in the market or whenever there is any opportunity to actually use some fund and pump into the equity, your debt funds will help. Never underestimate your debt funds. Other than that, complete portfolio is beautifully placed. If his risk profile permits, he can add on some mid-cap or small-cap fund in his kitty, if his risk profiling is suiting to it.
All right. I think we've more or less covered all of the topics that we intended to cover with you. Thank you so much, Anand, for taking the time and for speaking to us, for clarifying the queries that were asked by our viewers as well. It's been a pleasure speaking to you.
Having me on the show. Thank you so much.